Yep. Good morning, Wesley. Well, we're just tickled to death to be here again, and we're skinny-fied again. But you know what that means? That means that you guys really have to really, really sing. Now, I've picked out some camp songs for you guys, and Marietta recommended one of them, and I'm going to try to do more and more of these camp songs. There's so many old songs that I grew up with, Don, that they're just, you know, I kind of forgot about them. So we're going to sing one of those today. Andy, did you want to say something? Do you want to dedicate a song? Oh, later on. Okay. Okie dokie. You want to stand? Let's see here.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages though his praises sing, glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ my Savior, standing, I'm standing on the promises.
Good morning. How y'all doing? I'm wasting time while I find my notes. Lord is my help. This is our week coming up, August 25th through the 29th. Get with Linda or Dick. Card making and paper craft fun will be the 13th for the UMW. You can see all the information on there. It's for adults and youth 10 years and older. Let's see what else we got here. We have administrative council coming up on the 4th at 6:30. Charge conference is the 16th, which if charge conference is the 16th, it means we got to have our paperwork in on the 9th. So if you have a report due, we finally have them out there. I love it. They made charge conferences sooner this year and put the stuff on the website later this year. So, typical form. Any other announcements? No? Good deal. Prayer concerns, you see them in the bulletin. Are there other prayer concerns from the congregation? Yes, Wanda. Okay. Are you going somewhere?
Okay. Well, thank you, ma'am. All right, we'll just take up the collection and go home. We sang a song, she preached a sermon, we'll just take up the collection and go home. Sydney. Good deal. Yes, sir. Very good. Did y'all hear that? We have someone sleeping on our playground. And if anybody calls the cops, we're going to have an issue. I'm just going to go ahead and tell you up front, unless they go inside the building, they're perfectly content sitting out there underneath the shade. So we can get them some water if we need to. So he's asking that we pray for him to find home. Yes, sir. Terry's doing a good job. Go ahead. Okay, thank you. Yes, ma'am. Sherry. Yes, ma'am. Now, Patty is, you know, you don't think an earache can put you down. An earache can put you down in a heartbeat. So keep Patty in your prayers. She's had a bad week this week. Yes, sir.
A little something about Sherry. Sherry had open heart surgery this week, and she's in the hospital right now, recovering well. Give a praise for her healing.
Praise for Sherry's healing and prayers for Sherry's healing.
As many of y'all know, I served Colville United Methodist Church before coming here. I ask that you keep that church in prayer. They have had a devastating week. One of the sweetest young ladies I've ever met took her own life last week, last Sunday, or Saturday. I found out about Sunday after church. And then they lost one of their longest standing members. So that church has been through a little rocky road lately. They survived me, they can survive this. So, you will keep them in your prayers. Let us go, Lord, in prayer, please. Most gracious God, we are so thankful that you love us enough to have chosen us as your ambassadors. We know also that we've let you down a few times, and we ask forgiveness for that, and we know and we have faith in your mercy, in your kindness, in your compassion, that you will forgive us. Help us to learn how to forgive ourselves, though, but give us the strength and the courage to be about your business. Open our hearts and open our minds and our spirits that we may hear you, that we may seek you out, and that we may discern your will. We complain about a lot of things about them when really it's us. Help us to renew our minds that we may be transformed in the Word, that we may live a life that is worthy to be called Christian. We come together for our friends and those whom we love. We pray especially for David and Linda, for Janice, for Gray, for Sherry, and for Patty, that you put your healing hand upon them. We pray for whoever it is that's sleeping on our playground. We're thankful that we can give shelter, even as it is. May that person find shelter in your arms. May we find a way to minister to the person. We also pray for your church, specifically for Colville, as they have been rocked this week, that you put your hands on them, that you give them comfort. We pray also for all of the folks out there that think that the only way to solve a problem is a gun, or a fight, or a knife. Help them to learn how to love as you have loved us. We pray for Glenda and her family as they deal with this part of their journey. Walk alongside them. Hear all these things as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You want to sing some more? What you going to sing?
We got another camp song, but this is one we normally sing around Easter, but it's just one of my favorites. It's Because He Lives. So let's get up and sing her loud. What do you say?
God sent His Son.
Just
is worth the living just because he lives.
One of my faves. Thank you. Okay, we got a nice one here. We hadn't done this in a long time. It's a beautiful song.
Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon a rock, and now I know I love you. Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay, you set my feet upon a rock, and now I know I love you, I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end.
Beautiful song.
Let us celebrate with our tithes and our offerings. Thank Let us pray, please. Most gracious God, once again we come to you. Out of gratitude, we return to you our tithes and our offerings, praying that they are pleasing in your sight. In your Son's holy name, amen.
We got a real treat for you this morning, I believe. Anyway, we've got Andy's going to sing this song, and this is just probably my favorite hymn, period. So I hope you like it as much as we like doing it for you.
I'd like to dedicate this song to my wife, who couldn't be here today because of health reasons, if y'all don't mind. Sparing, sent him to die.
shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration.
Great. I was ready.
We got shook up.
After that song, that was it?
Praise God.
From whom all blessings flow. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Pay attention. And today is about being a teacher. I'm going to write you over here and put you in here so we can. Okay? You can come. All righty. See? We sit up. We don't. Thank you. All righty. What do you think today's sermon's about, the way I'm acting? Jesus was a teacher, and this is back to school week, or for many of y'all just this past week, but some of us have been in 3 weeks or so. Like, you're going to listen. Don't we have to listen in class? We're not supposed to be playing with toys and stuff. But we are going to know that the disciples were in school. You think they were in school? Do I need to move you away from the tablecloth? All right. So how do you think Jesus taught the disciples? We have books, don't we? How do you think Jesus taught the disciples?
I think he taught them
things that he did. He didn't have pencil and paper like we do in chalkboards and everything. What? And now we have the word that's in written form. But what do they have to do when we study? How do we learn materials once we learn it? We have to, it starts with an M. Anybody know? No. M. What do you do when you study? You have to memorize. And how you take stuff and you read it, and you have to memorize it so when the test comes, we know how to put the answers. Well, okay, well, we'll learn about that later. But we're today going to learn how Jesus taught the disciples to do the prayers that he taught them, the act of kindness, the becoming disciples to go out once he was crucified, and to be able to go and do what they learned to teach others. All right. Do y'all remember when he asked the question, which is disciple, who do they say I am? Do you remember what disciple that was? With some of us learning some of the things that we've been doing in Sunday school? That's not up here to be telling on each other. We're learning the word. Okay, it was Simon Peter, and he said, do you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. That's how he answered. And it says, back in school time, many a times we are probably feeling excited, and some may be a little sad that summer is over, and that we feel nervous and a little scared about going back to school because of all new things that we have to face, which is a new class. From going from one class where you have friends, going into a new class that you might new friends and new subjects you're not familiar with. But on the first day of school, the teacher will probably ask some questions to see how much you retain. Well, that's got to be scary. Yes, that has to be scary. So when the teachers ask these questions, you might answer with excitement. Well, that's good. That means you are very confirmed in how you feel. Other times, we're not the ones that are excited about putting our hands up because we're not sure what the answer might be. But I know last week in y'all's class in Sunday school, we prepared for a game called Jeopardy. And I heard y'all did excellent because y'all had to go home and read scripture. And what is that word we said? M? Memorize, so you'd be ready for coming back to be able to answer what Jesus' word teaches us. So, today's Bible lesson, the disciples are going back to school. Can you guess their teacher was always who? Jesus. Well, that's what we learn in vacation Bible school. If anything you learn, the correct word is
Jesus.
So, that's good. You remember that. That shows a sign of willing to retain the information that we learn out of the books and what we're being taught by peers and pastors and teachers. So the disciples' aside of the teachers' important lessons was that of the kingdom of God to prepare us. So like I said, we have today books, and I say books are great. Computers are all right, but books are great because they can't distract you by what the games are pushing a button on your laptops or your phones or anything. They are, you just have to memorize and learn and just put that knowledge in your head for when days that you have classmates that are ugly, you can just go up and hug them and say, God loves you. That's the things we learn from the Bible. Or might be just something you remember, that Jeopardy. Well, that's a good thing too, maybe. But when we learn that Jesus taught his disciples and went out, and the answer was, who do you say I am? The word is Jesus. Or Jesus always said, I am, which meant he was God as well. So for other disciples to raise their hands and know that some of the people they said was Elijah, this is, he was also referred as prophets, but these are people that did not know him as well as the disciples did. They could call him Jesus or Savior. So when we leave today, you can feel good that he is your Savior. You can call upon him when you're down. And by coming to Sunday school each week and being prepared to learn and have that openness, you're going to be able to, when the days come when we're sad or hard, You can think about what you've learned through Sunday school and rely on calling on Jesus. So, what do you think Miss Wanda has for you now? What do you go to school and you get when you go home? You get papers, don't you?
Homework.
And what do you think this homework is?
It's going to let you get into the Word and learn about our Christ Savior. So, hold your hands out. What this is going to do, this is what you see in most of your tests, the multiple choice, and then the word search. And it's going to help you remember certain words, and it's going to give you a little storytelling that will help you remember about the story today, being disciples, and they had to be taught as well as we do to be followers of Christ. So have a good week.
Our scripture today is Romans 12, 1 through 6. While you're looking for that, thank you, Andy, Rich, and Rod. That was awesome. So, I was telling Rod, you know, I found it. This is not an anti-contemporary, anti-praise music sing. But, you know, they always tell you got to have the head-banging stuff to get people excited in church. Yeah. You got to have the head-banging stuff, okay? There was no drums. It was just a keyboard. That was it. Just in songs. You go to a camp meeting, one time. You'll know what I'm talking about. I mean, they sing them old blood songs, and everybody is ready to whoop and holler afterwards. So that was fun. I really like that. There's a lot of, by the way, this is just an aside, there's a lot of research out there now that's saying our young people, that's the ones that we think we have to do the headbanging music for. The young people are screaming and hollering for that music. You know, they want something that's got meat in it, that says, tells a story. You know, we have done all these hymns a disservice when we do the first and last, because most of them tell a story. You have to read the whole thing. So that was wonderful. By the way, do you know how great Thou Art is? It's written like 53, 59. It's not an old song. We always think it's an old song. I guess because George Beverly Shea was old and he sang it. I don't know. You know, could be. Let us stand for the reading of God's Word, please. Paul says to us, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to you, everyone among you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You can be seated. Well, I was going to preach this morning on who do you say I am? And we think that's a very easy answer, by the way. It's not a very easy answer. If you take that little verse seriously, that is not a really easy answer. Oh, yeah, I know we say, oh, he's the Messiah. Oh, he's the Savior. Oh, he's that. But what do we really mean by it? If you really dig deep into that one verse, it's a killer, man. It'll mess with your brain for a while. Or maybe I just think too much. I don't know. Could be. Y'all all know I love hats. And I always have a hat on. I just bought a new one. You'll see it shortly, but it's not Labor Day yet. It's black. It's just like this one, but it's black. Now, the funny thing about it, or the interesting thing about a good hat, especially a Panama hat, is that when you first buy it, it seems a little large. And this one was a little large when I first bought it. But the interesting thing is, you know what a hat will do? A good hat. Now, bad hats will tear up. But a good hat, they'll shrink to fit your head. Seriously, I don't make this stuff up. They will shrink. They will conform to your head. That's why you don't mess with a man's hat, okay? There's other reasons. It's just rude and it's nasty. But don't mess with somebody's hat. My other hat hadn't shrunk to fit my head yet, so I have to be real careful when the wind blows. We kind of do the same thing if you think about it. We're kind of like that old lobster. You turn the water on and you heat it up, and you put the lobster in there and heat it up, you know, and the lobster don't know what got him until he's dead. We kind of are that way, by the way. We have allowed things to happen over the years that we just, now it's consuming us. I mean, we've allowed evil to stick its nose up underneath the tent. We've listened to the off-color joke or the racist remark, and we think they're innocent until we learn that we're starting to hate people and think we're better than somebody else because of it. People have always called me a nonconformist as an insult. I find it kind of as a compliment myself. Doesn't mean you're a troublemaker. Just some things just ain't right. Paul says to us, he says, I appeal to you. Appeal. That's a different word, by the way. We don't think about it. Appeal is a pleading. I think King James actually says, I plead with you to please transform, not be conformed. He says, I beg you. You know, what he's doing, he's pleading, he is begging basically the church at Rome and us to change. You see, what we want to do is, you go ask somebody to go to church with you. Hey, you want to go to church with me? No, not really. Okay, thank you. And keep right on trucking. He says we are to plead, okay, to as John Wesley says, plead with them to escape the wrath which is to come. It's an urgent plea that he has here for people to change before it's too late. You see, we have become so complacent that we don't see the urgency to change anymore because we feel like we got plenty of time, right? I mean, modern medicine tells me that I can live to be 120. Jesus tells me I can live eternally. How do you like them apples? We got it before modern medicine did. Paul calls the church, look what he says, brothers and sisters, you have to love someone that intimately as your family members if you want to plead with them. Otherwise, we just don't really care. You're saved, you're not saved, no skin off my nose. He says, brothers and sisters, people whom I love, you know. Do we really think of people outside of these walls as our family? I know whenever every church says the exact same thing. We're just like a family. You don't really know what you're saying when you say that, by the way. Families argue. Families fuss and fight, right? Okay. Families are also very exclusive, but that's a different story. But do we think of the guy sleeping on our slide out there as family? Is it something that someone we love? We don't know him. But it says we should love him anyway, right? And plead with them. Y'all know the difference between a friend and a family member, right? A family member will give you a kidney. A friend will ask you to take up a donation. That's what my daughter always used to tell my other daughter. She says, you better be nice to me. You may need a kidney one day. He says, I appeal to you. I plead with you, brothers and sisters, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies, your life, as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Y'all believe God's been merciful to you and shown mercy and compassion and grace to you? Paul says, and we show it to others as well. Out of all the mercies that God has given to him, please present yourselves. Present your lives. Present. Summoned. That's what the word implies. You have been summoned to appear before God and plead your case. It says, present your lives. Present your bodies as a living. Present everything you got to God. Not just putting money in the plate on Sunday morning. Not just showing up on Sunday morning. Not just doing something good for one person and being done with it. It says, live your whole life committed to God. It's an all-in situation. He says, you know, a sacrifice, a Jew would understand what the sacrifice was. A sacrifice was not killing people. It wasn't about the death of the animal. It was about giving the life of that animal to God in appreciation for what God has done for them. It's the unblemished one. It's the good one. It's the first fruit. He said, bring it to the altar and say, God, this is my devotion to you. This is what I give. Now, what Paul says is one step beyond that. It says we give our lives as that sacrifice to God for what God has done for us. We're all in. It's all of us into it. It says gratitude for all the mercies that God has shown us. It says holy. We are to be very intentional about our worship. Not helter-skelter. You know, we just kind of let God flow over us like water. No, it's an intentional relationship with God. It's one that we got to work at. I'll tell you what. If you don't work on your marriage, you ain't going to be married very long. Okay? Trust me on that one. You won't be married long. You got to put work into it. You got to put work into this thing, this relationship that we have with God. It says holy, intentional, the best that we have. You don't bring to God the trash. You don't give to God the leftovers. We say, oh, we got to give 10%. Is that what he says? He says, bring me your first fruit. Your best. I've always found it interesting. I'm glad we don't have a parsonage, to be honest with you. Because people get feelings hurt over parsonages. You know why? Because whenever you get ready to throw something out, you say, let's just give it to the preacher. He'll be happy with that. Oh, yeah. We want that dented up furniture that's hanging on one leg there. You know, we put the 2x4s under to hold it up, but it's still got another year or two on it. I don't want it in my house, but we'll put it in that house. That's what we do with God, though, isn't it? We take what is left over. We take what we don't want anymore. Now, if I got a little money left at the end of the week, I'll give it to God. If I got a little bit of energy left at the end of the week, I'll give it to God. If I ain't got nothing else to do today, I'll give it to God. He says, make your life a holy and living sacrifice, acceptable to God. Not for show to others, but to the one and almighty everlasting God, which is your spiritual worship. You see, we have been given a new life. If you read backwards into Romans, what Paul has been talking about is being raised from the dead of sin and reborn with Christ. And because of that, we've got to have a spiritual worship where we give our whole self intentionally living for God. And then here we go. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Listen again. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. You know what the long short of it is? We're lazy. That's it. We are lazy. Christians, as a general rule, we are lazy. We don't want to have to do the work it takes to be transformed. It's easier to conform. It's a lot easier for that hat to just conform to my head. We like to conform. You know? We always say, but Pat, you don't understand. The world's different now. Society is different now. Who's society? Aren't you part of society? You? Me? Aren't we society? Then why is it different? So what you just said was, I have changed my values. I have changed my standards. I have conformed to what everybody else wants me to be. That's what we said. We're lazy. We, you notice I'm saying we, okay? We had much rather come to church on Sunday and hear the exact same thing you heard 20 years ago. For God's sakes, don't challenge your mind. I had a friend of mine defriend me yesterday. It did kind of bother me, actually. I was going to say it didn't bother me, but it does because I wouldn't say anything about it if it didn't. It was all over a theological issue. It was about the way something was reading. And I said, no, you really want to go back and read every version of that. In other words, it's in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And it says something different, slightly different on each one of them. And they didn't like that. They didn't want to learn anything new. They didn't want to be challenged. So they just defriended me. But isn't that what we do? Isn't that how we do things? It's easier to conform. That's what I've always, I used to always tell folks when I taught, I said, here's the deal. You can disagree with me. In fact, I'd like for you to disagree with me. Now everybody's going to disagree with me. I know Don always does. But I tell them, I say, here's the deal. You can disagree with me, except there's two things you cannot use. One is you cannot say, because mom and daddy told me so. That's not acceptable. And secondly, you can't tell me because the Bible tells me so. You've got to think it through to make a logical argument. Okay? We don't really want to do that with our scripture. We don't want to do that with our spiritual life. We don't want to be that intentional with our lives. It's just easier to let it wash over us. And if it changes, so be it. I haven't really changed. Yes, we have. Absolutely we have. You see? It's easier to conform than to be transformed, because to be transformed, we must submit ourselves, here you go, Don, in humility to God, to be used by God for God's will, and we'd really rather not work that hard. It's easier to laugh at the off-color joke or the racist statement than it is to take a stand for the one who so loved the world. It is easier to accept hatred of people not like us than it is to speak of a God who commands us to take care of the strangers. It is easier to deny care for people than to remember the one who dressed the wounds of the Samaritan. It is easier to find fault than it is to find good in folks. It is easier to judge than to clean up our own act. It's easier to say, have faith, I'll pray for you, it will get better, than it is to suffer with those who have suffered as Christ suffered with and for us. It is easier to walk away and ignore the pain and suffering of the world than it is to walk with those who suffer. So how do we get transformed? One, we have to submit ourselves in humility. Don't like that idea. I think I may have found part of the answer in Isaiah, of all places. I ran across this in my devotional this week, and it has haunted me, it has sustained me, and it has strengthened me. Isaiah 51:1 says, listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn and to the quarry from which you were dug. We are to pursue righteousness. Not sit back and wait for it to hit us in the face. It's not a passive thing. We pursue a right relationship with God and with others. We pursue righteousness. We pursue to do the right thing. It's work. It's not passive. We are to seek the Lord. Not just sit back and wait for God to find us. We are to actively pursue actively seek out. These are action words. And remember, I love this one. Look to the rock from which you were hewn. We were cut from good stock. We were cut from the same stock as Adam and Eve and Isaac, Jacob, Abraham, Ruth, Peter, John, and Jesus. We are from the same stock, from the same rock. Remember, from the rock from which we were hewn and the quarry from which we were dug. Do not conform, but be transformed. We have been given a new life. So how are we using that new life? The world says to us, look out for number one. And Jesus says, lay down our life for others. The world says, take it all. And the Word says, give it all. The world says, we can hate because they're unlike us. And Christ says, what? Love each other as I have loved you. How will we know what God wants us to do? And how will we be able to discern God's will if we don't open ourselves to God's Spirit? To renew our minds, our hearts, our souls. You see, in reality, we want God to conform to our will. But God says we are to be transformed so that we may conform to God's will. For by the grace given to me, Paul did nothing to earn his apostleship, by the way. He was chosen by God. He says, I say to everyone among you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. There was evidently a problem in Rome, as it was in Corinth, with those who lorded their gifts over everybody else. They were the super Christians. Y'all know them folks, don't you? Y'all know who I'm talking about. Hope none of us are in that boat. The super Christian who think they got a special gift that others don't, so they're better than everybody else. They can quote you scripture without context, of course, to make a point. And those who think they're special because they're more spiritual than others. The most arrogant statement I have ever heard is, well, I'm just spiritual, but I don't like to go to church. Well, ain't that arrogant? What they say is, I'm more spiritual than you folks, because y'all are hypocrites. I'm not. I've reached that plateau. I'm walking with God. But to think with sober judgment, how many of us really are really, really, really honest with ourselves? I mean, really. I know everybody thinks they are. We really aren't. I mean, before you answer it, think about those guys that came to Jesus. He said, Jesus, I want to follow you. And he says, then sell everything you own. And he said, well, wait just a minute. I didn't mean I want to follow you that bad. The guy says, I want to follow you, Jesus. And he says, okay, come on, he said, but I got to go home and bury my dad first. And he said, let the dead bury the dead. And he said, well, dadgummit, this may be 20 years from now. You want to be really honest with yourself? We're more like those guys than we want to admit. We must submit to God's Spirit if we are to make an honest assessment of ourselves, because we can't do it alone. It says, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. We need to understand that. We need to understand that our gifts didn't come from us. God gave us our gifts. All right? It is God who has given the gifts that we have. And we have no right to abuse those gifts by holding them over others or thinking we are better than anybody else. For as one body, for as in one body, we have many members. And not all the members have the same function. So we who are many are one in Christ. And individually, we are members one to the other. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. I can't walk on my hands. I know some people can, but I can't walk on my hands, and I can't type with my toes. My heart doesn't provide me with oxygen, and my liver doesn't provide me with blood. You hear what I'm saying? Every one of us has a gift. God has gifted each of us. So you need to determine what your gift is. You need to discern what is it that God has gifted you to do. And then do it. It's that simple. Figure out what your gift is. You say, oh, but I'm just too old. I'm too this. I'm too that. I'm too whatever. Telephone call, an email, a card, a smile, a prayer. We can do that. I had a bad week. I'm just going to go ahead and tell you up front. I had a bad week. I started out on Sunday afternoon getting a phone call that I told y'all about, the young lady that killed herself. Monday morning, I get a phone call from the vice commander, who said one of our wing members had been killed in a gun battle, basically, with another woman. Can you come out? Because guess what? Mom and daddy are on their way. I can deal with it. It's dealing with mom and daddy is the hard part. Then I had to deal with the fallout with the guy that was her supervisor that felt so responsible for it. Then Tuesday morning at 7:10, I got another call. One of our troops had just completely gone into nervous breakdown mode. That's no fun. I spent all day, I think Tuesday night, I answered my last page or my last, text at around 10, 10:30. Not a good week. Wednesday wasn't a whole lot better. Thursday didn't shape up a whole lot better than that. In the midst of all that, I got a beautiful prayer. Someone reached out and didn't know what was going on. We all have a gift. We got to share that gift. Our strength is not in our homogeneity, it is in our diversity. If we all did the same thing, if we all sang and played like Rich and Rod and Andy, then would theirs be any special? We all have a gift. I love what this says. It says, individually, we are members one to each other. We're interdependent of each other. Just like our body. You think that your body's not interdependent? Get an earache or a toothache and you find out how one of the smallest parts of your body can make you miserable throughout your body. We're in this thing together. We have to function as the body. We share a common life, and what happens to one happens to all. When one of us goes out speaking negatively about the church or about each other, then that affects the whole church. You see, folks, we want to believe the young folks don't want to come to church because we don't have the right kind of music or the right kind of atmosphere or whatever. They don't want to come to church because they're tired of listening to all of us fight. You want to know the truth? That's it. They don't want to hear all the bickering anymore. They can hear that at home. This is a generation that saw divorce rate go up 3 times. They don't want to hear it when they come to church. Remember the rock from which you were hewn and the quarry from which you were dug. We are born loving others. We have to be taught how to hate. We are born trusting others. We learn to be distrustful. We are born honest. You don't believe that? Ask a little one something. You will get an answer that you may not like, because they will tell you you don't look good in that dress. All right? We have to learn to be dishonest. We say we're Christian or Christ-like. Well, let's not take the Lord's name in vain and bring dishonor to it.
You see, Christ never conformed to this world, but he came and transformed the world. We got to stand firm in our faith. We have to actively pursue righteousness. We have to actively seek the Lord. We have to give our whole being to God because we're all in this together. Black, white, Muslim, Jew, Christian, we're all in it. Gay, straight, it doesn't matter. We're in this together. When one falls, it affects every single person. Think about that. One person dies, and look how many lives are affected. That one girl that thought she had no friends in the world, Colville holds probably, what, 200, 250, plus the balcony, another 100. They had standing room only for her memorial service. She thought nobody loved her. Robin Williams, look at the outpour. One girl carries a gun to work because she's fearful for her life, pulls the gun, ends up dead, and it destroys not only that girl, but the girl that shot her, the friend that they were after. It affected everybody in that restaurant. It affects everybody in my wing of 1,700 people. It affects me, and it affects you. You see, we're in this boat together. We are all one body. What happens to one affects us all. So let us remember the only, this is, by the way, how I got defriended. The only commandment Jesus ever gave us. Love each other as I've loved you. Amen. If God is working within your heart, you want to spend some time in prayer, time alone, time in silence, we invite you to do so as we have something, I hope. If not, silence works. Let us pray. Thank you.
Almighty God, we are your children. We open ourselves up to hear your Spirit as it speaks to our spirit. Help us to be transformed, to be intentional in our walk with you. Give us the strength and the courage it takes to stand firm. In your Son's name we do pray. Amen. Let's stand as we tell the world what it is we believe. Apostle Creed. Here we go. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're going to sing something. Ain't going to be a happy day, I know that.
We didn't pick this song because of the sermon, but this song is certainly appropriate with that sermon, preacher.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go.
Great job, y'all. Great job. That was good. I could feel that song building. Could you feel it building? I mean, it was like, yeah, good job. Good job, too, I'm telling you. That just makes me, that fills me up when we do that.
This happens to me.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate it, and I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, so that was great.